Hey everybody, when I was in school, sometimes I used to study really hard the entire day. But at the end, what would happen is that I would have very little information stored in my mind. It may have also happened that somebody told you their names and just seconds after you could not remember what the name was and it was even awkward to ask again. Our brain does all of this to make sure that we only have information that are very important in our brain. It tries to save information which are linked to safety and survival and remove everything else that the brain considers to be less important. Today, I'm going to teach you some techniques that is going to make a big difference in the way you remember things. Our brain has around 86 billion neurons and each memory is like a connection, a new connection between these neurons. The stronger the connection is, the longer and stronger the memory becomes. When you repeat something and learn something in a meaningful and exciting way, our brain releases a chemical called dopamine. And we have talked about dopamine before. And this chemical works as a glue to connect these neurons together. And if there is the presence of these chemicals, then the connection between the neurons gets very strong. You may have noticed that when you already are under pressure, when you have a lot of guilt inside you, or when you are already feeling very gloomy, the learning becomes much slower. But when you are really excited about learning, and when you feel that it's really rewarding, the learning becomes stronger, faster, and it remains for a longer period of time. It's not just dopamine. There is another chemical called adrenaline, and it also works as a glue to connect these neurons together. Adrenaline is produced when we are running or when we are involved in a physical activity or when it's a threatful situation. That is the reason why if a situation is really traumatic, it tends to remain in our brain for a longer period of time. But we can use it in a good way. When you learn something, you can later produce adrenaline in your body by going for a run or by taking a cold shower so that the learning, the connection between the neurons can stick with each other for a longer period of time. Another important fact is that brain scans and studies have shown that when you use techniques like visualization while learning, the part of the brain, hippocampus, which is majorly associated with memory, lights up in the brain scan more than when you would be remembering any information by just using the words and not the images. So using techniques for memory does not mean that you are working harder. It just means that you are rewiring the brain so that the learning can be way quick. Now let's dive into the first technique that is called visualization and memory palace. Imagine that somebody gave you a shopping list. It says milk, eggs, toothpaste, rice, and some chicken. Instead of just repeating those words to yourself, you can make a story out of it. For example, you can imagine that you went to your room and then you saw a chicken waking up in your bed. Then it goes to the bathroom, brushes its teeth, and then instead of going to the toilet, it lays some eggs. Once it has the eggs, it carries it to the kitchen. And in the kitchen, it prepares some breakfast. The breakfast has a rice ball and a glass of milk with it. Now, with the help of this story, we could remember chicken, toothpaste, eggs, milk, and rice ball, rice. We use this technique not just to remember things for a short term. I know that you could have memorized this list in less than 30 seconds, but the key is to remember it for a longer period of time. With some extra steps in encoding information like this, you will be able to remember things for a much longer period of time. And this was a very simple example. You can use the same technique to memorize difficult concepts and a lot of different words. And it may sound funny, but it's even better if the information and the images are unusual, because that way the brain can remember it in a much quick and easier way. Because remember, the chemicals, if it's fun, if it's exciting, then the chemicals like dopamine can be released, which is going to make the learning way more easier. And world champions in memory athletes use the exact same technique to remember a lot of different words, numbers, and even a deck of cards. We are going to talk about numbers and different facts later on in the video as well. The second technique is spaced repetition. Neuroscience says that when you repeat something at certain intervals, the brain tends to remember it for a much longer period of time because the connection between the neurons gets stronger every time you repeat the information. Think of it like watering a plant. If you put a full bucket of water into the plant at the same time, it's not going to be good. It's not going to be fruitful. But if you put a bit of water every time the plant needs, then it's going to be very impactful. It's similar in neuroscience and memory as well. There's one formula, one set of duration that I would like to recommend. First day, you can learn a new fact or a new concept. In the second day, I recommend to review it for 5 minutes. And then on the third and the fourth day, you can quickly just recall this information, not just learning it or spending a lot of time, but you can just close your eyes and recall that information easily. On the seventh day, do one more quick recall. Just remember this fact. It's like a quick revision. You can take help of flashcards and sticky notes to recall this information, because this way it's going to take a very small amount of time. If you repeat information like this, the brain gets a signal that this information is important, and that's why it keeps it inside for a longer period of time. This technique is also called active recall, and it is considered to be one of the most effective techniques for memory enhancement. Some other things that you can do to actively recall information is to take a quick quiz or a test that's going to help you to understand if you could recall information or do you need to revise it one more time. The third technique that we're going to learn today is associated with remembering numbers. Numbers can be a little difficult to remember, but the secret is that you can even turn these into stories. Let's say you need to remember a number, 24360. We can now make a story out of it. You can imagine two ducks walking and you are following them from behind. When you look from a lower angle, you can see four legs there, because there are two ducks and four legs. Once you keep on following them, you see that they lay eggs now. They have three eggs each. So they have three eggs and three eggs each, and you collect them all and you get six eggs. You take these eggs home and you prepare an omelette. When you see the omelette, the shape looks like a number zero. So you see two ducks, they have four legs in total. They lay three eggs each, and now you have six eggs in total, and you make an omelette out of it, which looks like the number zero. We are going to use this technique only if the information is really important. If it's not a very important detail, like if it's just a Google code that came into your mobile phone and you need to type it down in your laptop, then we don't need to use this technique. Short-term memory can easily help us do that, like 9675, 9675. We do not need to store it in our long-term memory. But if you want to remember things for a longer period of time, then either it has to be done by active recall and repetition, or by using a technique like this, where you make a story out of it. The fourth technique is chunking, which means breaking a bigger information into smaller chunks and pieces. And if we can make it meaningful pieces, it's even better. For example, if you want to remember a phone number, which is 9841632741, you can break it down into 9841642741. Now that's three chunks rather than 10 random digits. Chunking has two major advantages. The first one is chunking will help us to be less overwhelmed. Most of the learning gets stopped in the middle because we are so overwhelmed by the amount of information we have to learn. For example, when we see a thick book, it gets really overwhelming to start studying because we see the book as a whole. But if we just divide them into pages, and if we set a target that I'm just going to read this page, this chapter at once, it's going to be better. So the first advantage is that chunking can motivate us to start studying. Second thing is that chunking is beneficial because our brain loves patterns. And that's the reason why we can easily remember songs, because they are divided into meaningful chunks and we can remember that in a much easier way. I will give you my own example. I really wanted to learn Shiva Sotram. It's a Hindu mantra dedicated to one of the prime gods in our culture, Shiva. So when I saw the entire mantra, I loved it, but it was very difficult for me to get started. But then I set a target that I would just remember one phrase, one line at a time. And now I do not know the entire song, but I found a way to get started. And now I can recite it like Jatata Viga Lajjala Pravaha Pavitasthali. Now remembering one line at a time really helped me to go on with the entire song, and it has helped me to remember 6 to 7 lines now. So in this way, chunking can help us to stay motivated, and it can also help us to break learning into patterns which our brain absolutely loves. The fifth technique is remembering names. Did you know that remembering somebody's name is one of the most effective techniques for forming good impressions on somebody and building relationships? That happens because we love our names, and when somebody remembers it, we feel really special. So there are two ways you can remember somebody's names. Let's say you heard that somebody's name is Sagar. The first thing that you can do is you can repeat the name in the conversations. For example, you can say, "Hi Sagar, how are you doing? So Sagar, are you going for maybe the club this weekend?" You can repeat name in the conversation as much as you can. That's the first way of remembering name. Second, I also recommend you to link the name with a visual. For example, Sagar means ocean or sea in my native language. So what you can do is you can imagine that person swimming in the ocean, and you can make it as funny as you would like. When you do that, when you link the name with the image, and when you also repeat the name often, it's going to be set in your long-term memory way quick than it would be if you would just randomly memorize just the name internally by repeating the words. Another thing that you can do is if you know somebody who has the same name, like a celebrity or a friend of yours who share the same name, then you can try to find some connection between these two people, or you can imagine them together doing something. So finding this common ground will help you to save this new information in the same neural pattern, and it's not going to add a lot of mental load into it, and the learning process can be quicker. All the techniques that you learned till now is incomplete without this fact. Sleep is one of the most important memory tools. And when we are in sleep, especially during the REM sleep, which is rapid eye movement sleep, our brain processes and recalls all the information that we acquired, and it helps to strengthen the neural connections. Before the sleep, the information is like a messy room full of clothes. But sleep helps us to put the right things at the right boxes, right places. This can be very helpful when we try to recall the information. If you are studying for an entire night before the exam, it's not a very good idea. Because if you remember, what we learned before the exam comes in our mind easily, but what we learned immediately might not come because it might not have been processed really well. Exercise also plays a very important role because it helps to improve the blood movement in the body, and it helps to improve the memory and focus both. There are two instances that exercising helps a lot. First, you can exercise after you learn something to produce the adrenaline and to stick these neurons together. And second, you can exercise or have a walk before an exam. Maybe you can walk to the exam center rather than going on a bus. This can help to, you know, maintain the right focus and recall memory when it's required. If you found this video useful, share it with your friend and your academic community whom you want to see performing better. And also do not forget to subscribe to the channel because there is so much science-backed learning coming your way.